Please welcome Kim Väisänen.
Yeah, something new for the change. I have not heard about Mega Hunt before. And I'm sorry that I'm wasting your time. You could be there listening to a band and drinking beer. So hopefully the ride will be enjoyable. I heard that there's a tough competition if you whether you wanted to come here or go there. I think that you made a wrong mistake, wrong decision anyway. I got instructions that I should stand here and be still because they are going to try to film me. And it's impossible because I always move. And then the outcome will be that I will be in a film maybe 15 seconds time to time. But the thing is that I'm actually writing a book because that's the kind of thing you have to do. If you get a bit of success, you think that you're more clever than the others and then you share your knowledge. In my case, that's not true because I just want to write a book because I go out to this floorball team every Sunday morning. And more or less everybody in my, well, it's not a team, but gang of guys playing, everybody else has written a book. So I'm more or less the last one. I'm the leftover who has not published anything. And the guys are like, yeah, this is my 15th book and blah, blah, blah. And I'm the only one. And that actually gives us a good example about the environment where you actually work, how it gives you leverage. And therefore, quite a few successful companies are normally located in the same places because you envy the other guy so much that you want to beat him. Maybe not in the same field, but do certain things better than the others. And this especially applies our floorball team. And by the way, I'm the worst player. I'm not the worst player on world. I'm just worst player in Europe. However, floorball is not much played outside of the Europe. So I rest my case. Today I'm going to share my wisdom. But however, I would like to remind you about one thing. And it is that when somebody shares wisdom, it's always limited to the time. Everything is about timing, more or less. Is there anyone who follows basketball? Anyone? Oh, this is by the way, you shouldn't never ask in any Finnish present during the Finnish presentation, is anybody doing something because you're not going to get any. Yeah, I noticed that. You actually kind of stole my line. That luckily we have someone who is non-Finn here. But the thing is that whoever gives you any advice, it's based on that time. And then therefore, I want to give my disclaimer. And my disclaimer is that the Lonely Planet books, which were fairly successful until the moment that TripAdvisor came and kind of washed them from the market. But they have a great, in the beginning of every book, they have this disclaimer. And it says that the things change. Prices go up, schedules change, good places go bad, bad places go bankrupt. And that applies always to the advices. The advices are based that moment, that space, that country, and so forth. And therefore, whatever I'm going to say, it is not likely going to apply in 10 years or 15 years or different countries or so forth. And I've noticed that now when I've been writing a book, that you want to give general examples, things which would universally apply. But these things are universal. Things change. Do we agree on that? Yep. Prices go up. We agree on that. Schedules change. Yeah. Good places go bad, bad places go bankrupt. That's absolutely correct. But then on the right-hand side, we have Martti Ahtisaari, the Nobel Peace Prize winner. He says that you don't have to be with your stupid ideas rest of your life. And I think that's a great advice. And then I've been an entrepreneur about 20 years, to be precise. So now it's 97, I started 96, 97, 20 years, 20 odd kilos and bit of hair. And I've noticed that, some of the things which were my principles at the time have changed totally. Those are no longer my principles at all. And therefore, by the way, I know that now we in Aalto, everybody considers entrepreneurship being the future goal. Anyone who would think? There's a few people who hesitate. But it's an interesting fact that in Finland, roughly 15 years ago, when Company Society made a research, about 3% people on your age were interested about being an entrepreneur. Now it's 20 plus. Timing, once again, it's about timing. But this is the picture we have been getting about Finland for the last 10 years. That Finland is knocked out. That's Robert Helenius, and he's actually coming up again. He tries to make a comeback. And I think it's get old. Somebody knows probably better than me that in a few weeks or a few months, anyway, before the summer. And if this happens to him again, he's done. He's gone. There won't be any comeback after that because he's too old. However, this is the side which I see about Finnish economy. I don't see actually this one, that we have had a more or less a recession for the last 10 years. Zero growth, all the things going straight to the hell. But this is the side where I work and what I do. So the companies are getting, of course it doesn't work in display, but the thing is the companies are getting fairly well funding. Investments to the Finnish startups is growing year after year, and we just had a recent statistics. I think that roughly a week ago, 2 weeks ago, again, new record. And it shows that even there's a bit looming in the Finnish economy and Finnish society, at the same time, there's room for growth. And regardless what is the industry, you can do things differently, and you can achieve, you can find your own niche. And I, for example, have invested like, is it 12 or 13 companies so far? Some of them extremely successful. And tomorrow we will have a board meeting for the company called Framery. And before I started to making investments, I made myself a really clear criteria where to invest. And I totally screw it. Just come in. The thing is that I decided that it has to be software and it has to do something with the digitalization, i.e. that something traditional methods are actually replaced by the software solutions. And one of the first things which I invested was phone booths. It was like, doesn't quite a fit to the criteria. And then I invested exactly 3 years ago when I got a bit of money from the London Stock Exchange. And the company had 1 million in revenue 3 years ago. Then it went from 1 to 5. That's fairly okay growth, 500%. People would consider that's a good growth. Last year it went from the 5 year to 17.6 million. And we made roughly the same amount of profit as previous year revenue. And this year we are base of the 35 million and so forth. So it shows that sometimes you have to just follow your intuition. And then the phone booths didn't fit my criteria at all. That had nothing to do with. But I know that the headache, the chaos, which is in open floor offices worldwide, I know that phone booths might have some success there. I never dreamed that it's 35-fold after 3 years. I got lucky. Once again, timing. But the thing is that this is the great question that this is actually a better slide in Finnish, but the thing is that what kind of success you are aiming at? The success or success? And there's two people, she's actually damn old, 80-something Finnish lady, but this guy's really successful. He actually finished, I think it wasn't Boston Marathon, but marathon anyway. Big fat guy. I would consider that it's a success in big scale. But what is the mutual thing for the success? That I should talk about my own experience and my background. But the thing is that when people see you starting to be an entrepreneur, winning a couple of prizes, so forth, having an exit in the end, people think that it's linear. What a smooth ride. You started from the A, you went to the B, all the success in the meanwhile. But being an entrepreneur is more or less this. And if we count this, so it's 12. 12 pictures of which two are about the success and 10 are about, oh fuck. And I have experienced, I would say that it's probably 1 to 10 or 1 to 20, the real ratio. That being an entrepreneur and trying to do things is that you fail, 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 you fail. As simple as that. I have had a situation where I was trying to find 3 things in Spain, which is a fairly large country. Is it about 45 million people or so forth? I had lost country manager, which I was searching. I had lost all the money that company had because the guy kind of took the money with him. And then I was trying to find guy who would replace him. And it went from failure to failure to failure. Same thing in Canada. There was a guy who I considered in somehow, maybe not being a friend, but acquaintance who I was working with. And he had a really great saying. He had I don't get excited when I get orders. I get excited when I get paid. Doesn't it make sense? Getting orders, it's for the losers. Getting the money, it's a great thing. However, this guy stole from me 150,000. I didn't get too excited when I found out about this. And I probably spent in a legal cost 200K of, I don't know, a lot of money. I never collected any single cent from him. But I drove him to bankruptcy, just to give an example for the next sucker who tries to do that I will come after you. But it was failure after failure after failure after failure. But the thing is that the Winston Churchill summed up what it is, what is the success eventually. And I'm absolutely sure that everybody here remembers the story of the Winston Churchill. He was highly appreciated prime minister during the Second World War. He was absolutely great. He probably had also, he was also, it's quite surely we can say that he was manic depressive. But his maniac phases were always in the right time. But he lost the election straight after the World War II. That you had been a World War hero and first election in 45, he lost big time, totally. But he got rewarded later on. He got a Nobel Prize. Do you know what was, in which field he was awarded Nobel Prize? Anyone? Who would like to guess? Literature is the right one. And it's claimed that he got it only because they had to give him some reward. But the guy was great prime minister during the World War II. He lost the election straight after that. because he didn't care about the society when society was not in a war. He didn't want to more or less put in a place any improvements for the normal people and so forth. And that's why he lost big time. But he summed up what is a success. And if you consider being entrepreneur, if you're an entrepreneur, remember this. The real success is going from the failure to failure without losing your good spirit, your enthusiasm. And that's a great lesson. Are you still considering being the entrepreneurs? Forget about it. To go someone who raises a lot of money, work for them for the good money, and then if you still consider being an entrepreneur, then go to work someone else for the second time and raise your money, and then do it. And it's been said that there's never the great timing for the being an entrepreneur. If you are young, you are lacking the experience. If you're too old, you have the kids, you have the high maintenance, you have a wife, you have a kids, you can't take the risk. And this is partly true that the most successful Silicon Valley startups, I think that they are established with the people who have roughly, was it 38 years old. They have relevant experience and they have been around. And what I did, I'm not going to go through this too much because as I said in my disclaimer, probably most of these things don't apply in a few years or tomorrow. But the thing is that this is the Blancco. Blancco was a company doing data eraser software. That's probably the dullest job you can think of. Getting rid of data, it's like an undertaker. You bury your dead six feet under. And then it went from, we started from the fairly small place from Joensuu, which is north, if you don't know, northeast from the Helsinki. And there wasn't too much IT or software companies at the time. Nowadays, it's fairly, I would say, busy. At that time, it was great for the recruiting because everybody wanted to work for you. So you could always select the best ones. Nowadays, I don't think that I could make it. No. But the thing is that these are where we were at that time. When I sold the company. Now the company is a PLC in the London Stock Exchange. I still have a lot of shares, and if anybody is interested, I'm more than happy to sell it to you in a good price, because I'm going to make a lot of losses for those as well, because the stock price hasn't been favorable for me. But the formula for the success, it roughly looks like this. The outcome was that we sold the company at the time for 60 million euros. We made about 5 million profit a year, and we had about 50 million revenues a year. Roughly like that. However, what I contributed myself or what I invested for the company was just take a good feeling on your seat. How would you think that if you would have had to sleep next 150 nights on that seat? Would be kind of awkward experience. I did that because when you're flat broke and you don't have money, you actually always fly in tourist class. And then I did about 150 nights in tourist class, which is a fairly. However, I traveled about 3 million kilometers, which is quite a bit. You get the gold card with 80,000. 800,000, you get a bit more. You get 10 gold cards, and it was about 3 million. And I sent 447,000 emails. Okay, there's some replies as well, but all of that in 15 years. So it's quite a few per day. But I was a busy bee. Now when I have been writing a book and I was just asked by your mentor that how is it going? And I was like, well, it's not the same thing. That you actually have to produce something which means something. And emails, you don't have to mean anything. You just go and send them that I hate you. And the 1500 is, by the way, nights in a hotel. So I'm not a big fan of the hotels. Home sweet home. And that contributed, the left-hand side contributed what was the outcome on the right-hand side. And if we go a bit back, people think, most of my relatives and other such are like, hey, it was like this. You followed the path, you won, that's it. But it was from failure to failure, more or less. Here's another example. And this will be also in my book. This is the real life statistics. I'm a big believer in outbound marketing. Nowadays, everyone is a big fan of the inbound marketing. It is that you wait and somebody calls them and they want to give you a lot of money for doing nothing. That's the more or less how I summarize the inbound marketing. That you create some content that attracts people and they want to give you money. I believe it the other way around, that you chase the people. This is from the January till September. I think this is from the 2014. And this is our German sales office. It made 21,000 phone calls. You pick up the phone and call someone. They actually reach 3,600 people out of these 21,000 calls. And then I try to call people as well. And I would say that that's a ratio. For example, if today I gave 7 calls, probably one or two people answered in the end. Out of these 3,600, we got someone else to contact, 546. But what was the outcome? That out of the 21,000 calls, we made 7 deals. Not really great ratio. If you consider yourself a career in telesales, you are going to see a lot of success because you will go from failure to failure to failure to failure to failure to failure. And you call people who actually hate you. But that's part of being an entrepreneur. But the thing is that because we made our homework, we calculated that it cost us €2.50 per call. And cost per lead was €180. Which is fairly okay. Because it was 205,000. But then we had 5 deals, which were 90%, so we knew that we are going to get those. 60 points, about 16, and some other leads. But it's going from the failure to another. Do you still consider entrepreneurship as a great career move? If you are, then there's one brave one. But it's from failure to failure. But what is the number one company killer? This will be in my book, by the way. Then it's not my own idea. I stole it from someone else. Who would like to try? You have to sing for your supper, by the way. Keep that in mind. Anyone? If not, it's a lack of the market. Even if you have the world's greatest team, then you have the lousy market. Market wins. If you have a lousy team, but you have a great market, market wins. It requires that you have a great team and a great market, and then amazing things happen. That used to be MBA slogan in the past, where amazing happens. It requires right timing, that you have the right people on the right market, and then amazing things happen. In every other game, every other situation, market wins. And you all know prisoner's dilemma. There's 4 options. In one you win, all the others you lose. This is the same thing. Time is everything. If you would like to start now and produce NMT mobile phones, even you have the world's greatest team, you will lose that for sure. It requires that the team and the market and the timing are all in sync. Doing things a bit too early, you're going to burn all of your money and you're going to lose. Coming to the market a bit too late, you are underdog and it's not going to work out. But now when I have been doing this some research for my book, it actually shows that in most cases, being a pioneer doesn't really work out. Normally, pioneers, they are like pioneers in a war. They explode, there's a mine and so forth. That's an unfortunate fact. However, sometimes it works. Being Otis, somebody might remember, elevator company, first in the market, still in the business. Sikorsky, helicopters, still on the market, however, not the greatest. But in most cases, it doesn't work out. And for example, when we were in a data eraser business, we were not the first ones. I don't know, we were like 15th or so forth. We just did things a bit better than the others. And we got lucky. If I want to say you one thing, that the older you get, the more you understand that how essential it is to iterate. And I can say nowadays that I'm a Marxist. I'm 100% Marxist. However, I'm not like Karl Marx. I'm his American counterpart, Groucho Marx. He had a great saying, those are my principles, and if you don't like them, well, I'll have others. And that's especially when it comes to business model. You have to iterate, you have to change it. And I had a great pleasure that Professor Nina Nummela from the Turku University did like, I don't know, 10-year research on Blancco and a few other companies. And he drew this picture. And then for example, when our main business model was that we have international partner network, i.e. resellers. I said to Nate, this is the greatest thing. We are going to go and dominate the whole game. We are going to have the biggest and greatest. However, when it didn't really work out, I said something else. We actually had a franchising at one point, which is an interesting business model for the software company. You'd more or less give your company name to everyone, the company emails to everyone who wants to work with you, and then you split the revenue. And it's kind of franchising. And every time when I met this Nina, every 3 years, I said, Kim, let me remind you, 3 years ago, you said 100% different story. You had the opposite ideas. And now you claim that this is the greatest and best thing since sliced bread. And it was on this. You have to be flexible. You have to change your business model and other such. And then if we take a look, for example, something really common, like how we consume movies. The studios in the past were that we want to get paid for every movie which we show. And nowadays you can get Netflix or HBO and so forth, and you get all the movies, all the TV series and so forth for the subscription fee. And I believe that most of the things in the world will become subscription-based. And there's one reason for that. Because the final decision about spending money comes from CFO. And CFOs, they hate the idea of the risk. They hate the idea of that something which is not being agreed happens. And subscription, you don't have surprises. It is what you pay for. There's no risk. And this is the challenge for the most of companies which sell the subscriptions. Companies and people acquire the subscription, but they don't consume as much as they think. And then there comes a churn. Certain percentage of the customers you will lose after every quarter, after month, because they notice that, hey, I have the HBO, I watch one series, or one episode last month. Why should be paying 10 euros? I should have, probably it would be better that I would pay 3 euros per episode. What's one here and then. But this is about iteration, the business model. This is I would say that if there's a biggest sin which Finnish companies are doing, that they are doing too many things. They try to go too many countries. They try to have too many products in their portfolio because they do not have faith for focusing. They don't focus. I was the same thing when we started. I don't know, we have like 30 different countries when we were selling things or selling products. Then we got rid of 10 and then another 10, and then the results started to roll in. Because when you focus, you will get the results. And this is the interesting thing that quite a few Finnish companies, when they release something, for example, online, for example, SaaS business, they release it to everyone, everywhere, and so forth, and they think that they're going to win. And now when I did the research for my own book, I took a couple of examples. For example, Facebook, when it came available for all the people, or everyone who was over 13 and has an email address, took 3 years. Then they opened it to everyone. Before that, it was more or less that you needed the invitation. You probably don't remember, but you needed the invitation. You had to be in a certain university and so forth. They started from the East Coast US, that you had a Harvard and a few other schools. When they noticed, okay, it's going fairly well. Okay, let's add something from the West Coast. And when they started in the UK, they selected just 16 universities. You need one of those 16 universities email address in order to be in a Facebook. Then they added few companies like Apple and Microsoft and so forth. By the way, when they came public, or the service came available to everyone, they had already 10 million users. But they went step by step. Same thing with Spotify. I remember that I went to Spotify. I had to have a fake UK address and so forth, use a bit of VPN and so forth, so that I came from somewhere else. It wasn't available for everyone. It took over 3 years before they started to accept customers here and there. And they raised like 100 million just for the launch in US. That happened after 2.5 years. Focus. Something wake. Homework is not done. And I can guarantee you one thing, that now when the Shark Tank Alliance will start again in Finland, there will companies who will say that my product does not have, my service or my product does not have any competitors. That's the, I go maybe 100 cases per year, you know, potential investments per year. And I hear it like every second time. We don't have direct competitors. Then you go and ask Mr. Google, and probably in 15 seconds you can find 3 different direct competitors which they have not heard of. We don't have competitors. This is so unique. Nothing is unique. One thing out of the million is unique. If there's not the direct competitors, there's indirect competitors. As simple as that. Do your homework, because otherwise you will be eaten alive. And when you're doing your homework, and especially when you're a startup, you don't have resources. You probably have got money from the 4 different sources, friends, fool and family, and Finvera. And it doesn't carry you too far. It's like a 4 freaking places that you have to really target and segment. And then in order to do that, avoid this. This is the Finnish teleoperator, I guess, I don't know what they call nowadays, Elisa, but when they launched their own product, or they became, they transformed from the being Helsingin Puhelinyhdistys to Elisa and merged with the Radiolinja. They said that I want to sell to everyone, everywhere, all the time. Actually, it's much longer, but I just took this part. That's the worst segmentation you can think of. And actually, I have written about this to my upcoming book. And there's a twist which I didn't remember, because it actually, the slogan was written in some way that it was divine, the message. And I didn't recall, but the Finnish church was fairly upset that the company put themselves in a position of God. There was a some kohu, I don't know how to translate that, but there was more or less a lot of talk about it. This is how you do it, and this is my own innovation. It's damn good, because I'm gonna make it a big thing. I call it that it's paper folding segmentation. And normal paper you can divide to the 7 pieces, until to the moment that Mythbusters came and they took a paper sheet which was size of a football field, and they managed to do it to the 12 pieces, which kind of ruins the old myth that you can't fold paper more than 7 times. But the thing is that if we think this A1, which is the biggest, and then the ELISA segmentation is that you try to get all of this at once. However, you should start folding the paper. And you started that you have a big paper, you go folding, you can do it 7 times. And this is an example. Do you want to be a game company? Or do you want to be Xbox educational games for the semi-autistic kids? That's the segmentation. And there's a reason why you have to do it this way. And the reason is that this is your market potential. But that's your capability. Think about that. That's your capability, and you spread the capability over the paper. What's going to happen? Are you going to be successful? No, you're going to burn the money which you raised from these four Fs without success. And I think that the biggest take which you can take from today is that the segmentation. You have to really do it. And it requires a lot of courage to concentrate on something. But you do it anyway in your life. For example, there's a charming gentleman and beautiful woman in the audience. One day you have to choose with whom you're going to have kids and raise the family and marry. You can't fool with everyone. And the same thing applies to the business. You have to focus, and you have to be faithful to the segment which you decide to go after. And when you have conquered that segment, then you can fool around as much as you want, because you have money and you can go to the next segment. By the way, don't apply to your personal lives, please. When your capability is that when you divide paper 7 times, it's 0.78% from the starting point. It's not more. And when you start recruiting people, this is, I learned this hard time, you have to respect the talent. Because the productivity with the good employee and bad employee can be tenfold. And then this is from a few years back, it's Miami Heat opening 5. And this is the great thing that they actually publish everybody's salaries. So Chris Bosh, 17.8 million. Dwayne Wade, 19 million. And then you have Dwayne Wade, about 19 million as well. But then you have opening 5-2 guys who make about 1/5, which the Stars are making. By the way, they won the NBA title that year. And that's the unfortunate fact. I have recruited a lot of salespeople, and in the end I had like 50 salespeople, which is the most toughest job you can imagine. Salespeople are demanding. They are high maintenance. They are like a fleet of motorboats. They consume your time and your money and insurance and so forth, but nothing guarantees that there will be results. Respect the talent. And the incentives actually drive behavior. When Olli here says that do your homework or otherwise we'll give you F, it's an incentive, because you don't want to fuck up your future and do like me that drop out from the university and become an entrepreneur and take a 15-round boxing match and hope that you will win in the end. And the thing is that the incentives more or less define if you find someone who is mean and lean, or if they are like Homer Simpson. Right, incentives. And I had three kids and I have learned that incentives drive behavior. However, you normally combine the incentive with a threat. Arne, my son, is 5 years old and he has a game day every Saturday morning. He can play games for 2 hours. And my incentive this morning was that if you don't behave, I will cancel your game day. Great incentive. He behaved fairly well. He put his clothes on and off we went. But incentives. However, there's one great challenge with the incentives. And it is that most companies have incentives which are like a pilot's windscreen. They have a lot of different meters which go different way. If you turn left, one goes right, one goes red, other ones goes green, and so forth. And in bigger companies, I have noticed that they have sometimes incentives that if you can make someone else unsuccessful, it's better for you. And then it's not optimized. I actually did couple of companies incentive plans last year, and it was fairly, I would say, educational to see what kind of incentive plans companies have in place. But it's essential that people are get incentives for the right things. If you are in sales, you don't get incentive for being nice and smiling and dressing nicely. You get incentive for closing business. As simple as that. And the worst situation is that salespeople start asking that, what is our strategy? The end is near. When they talk about strategy instead of closing the next thing or next customer, you're fucked up. The end is near. And somebody claims that when the companies are getting nice furniture and like here, the end is near because they're spending their money from wrong things. I don't entirely believe to that. But let's talk about exit because I think we have like 5 minutes left or so forth. There was a ex-Finnish member of the parliament, ex-wrestler from the USA, Tony Halme, and he had a tattoo in his buttocks which said exit only. And that's the only place where it belongs. Exit only thinking is straight from the ass, if you ask me. Whenever you think of exit for your company, you are not concentrated on customers. You are not thinking about well-being of your employees. You are not thinking how you're going to develop and how you're going to improve your company for the next thing, because you are thinking about your exit. And when I started in 96, 97, I was like, yeah, I'm going to do this 3 years and then I'm going to have an exit. Well, it took 15 years, which is a fairly long time, but the exit came. But in the last 5 years, I never thought about I wasn't thinking about exit at all because it was irrelevant. Because the good companies have always a price. The good companies are always acquired, regardless what is the market situation. The multiples might be a bit lower when economy is not great. But good companies can be sold any day. Therefore, don't think about exit. Think about great company. The only thing which you have to think is how I'm going to improve my sales, how I'm going to improve my staff, how we're going to be better tomorrow, how we're going to make more money and so forth. Because the exit, if you want, it will eventually come. At the same thing, now I'm involved with something which is already bigger than my own company was. Okay, I invested the money and I'm the chairman of the board for the company and so forth. We don't think about exit. The guys are now thinking that how we're going to make this company 100 million in sales. Because if you want to have an exit, you can have an exit. Good companies can be always sold you can sell always good companies. There's a price. It's like a beautiful girl. You don't have to market too hard. You will find a market, that's for sure. And then, hope is not a strategy. And then, one of my opening slides was about Robert Helenius, who was just experienced knockout. And this has been a challenge for the Finnish economy. We thought that we hoped that things are going to get better. We just wait another year and it's going to get better. We have now freaking, we have waited 10 years. Now finally it's going to get better. There are countries which actually changed quite a bit of their labor market, regulated things or deregulated things and so forth. But hope is never a strategy. You have to do things. If you hope that tomorrow I'm going to be in better condition, I'm going to be more fit, it's not going to happen. You actually have to do something about it. Don't hope, just do. And therefore, even if I didn't manage to inject you, I'm never going to be entrepreneur disease. If you're going to be, don't think, just do it. It's not that hard. I made it and somebody else can make it. And I had a guy who used to work for me and I said to him that I could sell you a couple of percent of my shares, like 3% or so forth. And he said, I don't want that. I don't want to do that. And I said, how come? He said that if monkey like you can make it, so can I. And he established his own company. Unfortunately, he's a good friend of mine and he hasn't yet come extremely successful. And given that he had that few percent, he would have made few millions. But he was aiming something higher for his own company. And he just followed this. He just did it. I think that the food is arriving. So let's have some few questions for the end.
Sure. Okay. All right. Let's give a mega hand again.
Who has some questions?
So we have a
catchbox.
Catchbox.
Let's start from there.
Yes, my name is Christian. I would want to ask: is there some other tips than segmentation and people that are important for starting company?
Great question, because I have listed all of those in my upcoming book, which you can acquire. Because my next aim is that my book would be somehow bestseller. In Finland, it means that you sell 500 copies in business books. It's bestseller. Then you take it, it's bestseller. But the thing is the people, the segmentation, concentration, focus, I think combine those is a great thing. But then there's a philosophical question. Is there a market? Is somebody really needing my product or my solution or my service? And that's the biggest thing, that whenever you think that hey, if I push enough, there will be demand. It's not going to happen. And that's the philosophical thing, that you should really start with the hard question. Is there demand for this? Can I sell it in Finland or can I sell it outside of Finland? Is there any hopes for the being export company, for example, if you want to grow big? And for example, if you're a producer of Finnish mammy, our delicious Easter food delicacy, I don't think that there will ever be any demand outside of Finland, regardless how much you push. But I think that the success is easy. You execute, you take a look, you make a changes, you correct. You execute again, you say, oh fuck, I did another mistake. You have to iterate. It's not from A till B, it's like ping pong in a drying machine. You go from the one end to other extreme end. But great question. Sorry for the lousy answer. There's a next one for the...
Oh yeah.
this decision to become entrepreneur, do you need to have something like some competitive advantage or something to bring to the table, or is it just enough to have intent to work hard?
I think it's 99% is the work hard part, and 1% is the inspiration. And I know some people who have made hundreds of millions net worth, who I think that they are morons. But they have the energy. They believed the things before when no one else believed. And they were pushing and they were great in execution. And I think that there has been a lot of research who is the great, who is the entrepreneur type. And I think that more or less every time the outcome is that you can't just define. But believe me that nobody is that successful that they have a company which is worth of hundreds of millions just by luck. Because there's one thing, and it's called competition. that if nothing else takes you down, that you have a that you have a great market and your time is great. There's always a one thing you can count on: it's competitors, and they will go and cut your throat if they can. But the thing is that not all the people can be entrepreneurs, because who would work for the entrepreneur if we all would be entrepreneurs? There has to be someone. And I don't think that it's like a marathon running or throwing javelin or doing something like that, that not all the people are capable of being entrepreneurs. If you can't take any risks and making any decision will take for your eternity, don't be an entrepreneur. Because entrepreneur, you have to do decisions all the time. And most of them, they will fail. A good example is that I have experience in my own company, quite a few other companies, that recruiting a US salesperson, which is essential if you're going to be a big in US, 2 out of 3 will fail. So when you start the recruitment process, you know that my chances of succeeding and finding the right person with right price is probably less than 1/3. And you go and do it anyways. But the cool thing is that American salespeople, you can't get rid of like this. It's called at will. I don't like you. At will. You have a wrong kind of trousers. At will. But they are fairly well paid as a base salary.
Any final questions here?
Is it final?
Or if there is more.
There is at least one. There's two.
Yeah.
The exit, was it a pain or a pleasure for you?
I remember one thing, and this is kind of, I would say, personal thing. The day when I actually got the money, and it was quite a bit of money, I remember only one thing. I had severe fight with my wife, like severe, you know, like almost domestic violence kind of fight. And you just got sick load of money, and you can remember one thing from that day. You had big fight. So I don't know if it was a curse or blessing. At least in the mornings at the moment, I can wake up and take my kids to the kindergarten and start writing my book. So in that way, it's a blessing that I can choose things which I want to do. And I wouldn't be here if I wouldn't want to be here. But, okay, he has some embarrassing pictures of me, but that's another thing.
My name is Irina, and I'm now doing or finalizing my PhD, so my questions will be maybe a little bit different from the ones before. I want to return to one of your slides where you showed us which countries you were operating in. At some point you said that there were like around 30 countries. It was a slide just before the formula for the success.
Yeah.
Did you have any specific strategy for choosing those countries, or was it just pure luck?
Sometimes we found a person who was willing to sleep with us. And he said, well, why not? Let's establish a company to New Zealand. Sometimes it was successful, sometimes it was extremely unsuccessful. But the thing is that being present in the bigger countries was essential for our growth. So we had to be in US, UK, Germany, Japan. Mm-hmm. we did a big market research together with the UCLA, which is a fairly good school, and with the MBA program about China, and we never went there. And now I, first part of this year, I was traveling with family in Australia, New Zealand. I saw some of our previous colleagues. Now, after 3 years, they are considering going to China. Okay. So there has been a lot of considering, because I consider it at least 3 years, and now they have considered 3 years. And eventually it might happen. So it just shows that, that things don't evolve that fast. And I think that going to China is just, for the software business, it's fairly difficult. The piracy rates are, well, I saw some research, 98%. And Adobe, which is a fairly large company, was there, and then they noticed that, well, being here costs us more money than we get actually revenue. So they kind of shifted away from there. But I think that now when the cloud and SaaS services are here, so piracy is coming more and more difficult. Mm-hmm. But it was mostly planned. Somewhere like being drunk and doing wrong things, kind of that you ended up to the wrong places where you shouldn't be, like Hungary and Hong Kong and so forth, but we pulled from there.
And then you also mentioned the research by Nina Nurmila, and you mentioned that you had to change your business model several times.
Yeah, I think we have changed it like 4 or 5 times.
What do you understand by business model?
When you have a customer here, and you are here, the business model is that how your product or service is delivered to the end customer. That's I consider business model. And there's like half a dozen of ways of doing it. You can do direct sales, or you can do licensing, or so forth. Mm-hmm. And this is more or less the part which I haven't yet written to my book, but it's probably the longest part, because I have experienced all the mistakes and beyond in business models.
And what was the most frequent reason of changing the business model?
Being greedy. We wanted to make more money.
Great answer. And if I may, my last question. You mentioned that if there is no market, there is no reason to push. Do I understand you right that you can't actually create market?
You can't temporarily, in a really, I would say that really short period of time, you can create a market, but it will fade away for sure. I'm a big believer that there has to be market, there has to be some kind of demand. You have to solve something. If you come up with something which is 100% totally artificial, you might be able to push it for some time, but it's not gonna work for a long time. And I have made 3 years investments to the startup companies. I made my first loss. 160,000 euros, thank you. What was the reason? There was no market. That you have to put your money where your mouth is. When I was making the investment, we were wondering with my friends in Takeoff Partners, who lost also their money, that is the market been big enough? That is there a market? And we were, yeah, there must be a market, because we're so excited about the opportunity. And it took roughly, I don't know, 7 months, 8 months to lose 160,000 euros. That kind of sucks. But lesson learned, there has to be a market. And market has to be big enough.
Thank you for your answers.
There's at least 2 questions.
One last one.
Let's take 2, because they were same time. Well, I know that you're hungry, it's too late, but.
Thank you very much. Kim, I was just wondering, is risk taking part of the element towards your success? And if so, what is your attitude towards the overall sort of Finnish behavior towards taking risk? Because it appears to me, as a foreigner in Finland, that everything goes in a certain pattern, and if there is anything new or different, is completely, you know, out of the case. So what's your take on that?
Yeah, that's a great question. A good friend of mine who used to be my lawyer, even though he's my friend, or he became my friend, who's no longer my lawyer. So he said that, Kim, you are world best of K getting to the trouble. However, you are the world best coming out of the trouble. So I can make fairly fast, really bad decisions. That's my skill, that I can make really fast, bad decisions. But I make a lot of them. And some of the bad decisions end up not being that bad. I think that, and then other things, you have to be really thorough in your execution. That I'm not the most disciplined person, but for example, running a company, it means that every Wednesday you meet the R&D team and you actually focus what they have there on their mind. And after that, you meet the salespeople, that you have certain structures. And I think that the biggest thing which I have recently learned is the difference between process and project. And those are fairly obvious for most of you. But now I have learned that certain things in life are projects, and certain things in life are processes. And then, like being in a fit or trying to at least have some functional body, it's a process. It's not a project that, hey, I'm going to do it next 3 months and then I just forget about it. And the same thing applies to the business, that you have to fairly well understand what things are processes. You do day after another, you do year after another, and you just execute. And what things are project, that you sank a lot of time and effort, short period of time, and then you do it well and move on. And I have noticed that in employees, you have process people, and then you have project people. And the biggest mistake is that you put a project person running a process. And they are really excited about that 3 months, and after that they couldn't give fuck about it. The same applies to salespeople, that certain salespeople are project people, that they go on and close a business. After that, they don't care about the customer at all. It's like when tail lights disappear and they have got their commission check, they couldn't care less about customer. And you have to realize who are project people, who are process people, and then make them a team, that somebody goes and closes a business, and then somebody is a farmer who takes care of the customer. Last question.
Thank you. So to add on to an earlier question, I just got a little bit confused there. By market?
Me too, so.
By market, do you mean more market demand? So the example I was thinking of is, obviously when the running shoe, for example, was introduced, there was no so-called market for it, there was no sales, but eventually it became to be a huge business. So I would just like to clarify, do you mean market demand by, is there a market for it? Or yeah, something else perhaps?
Certain things don't have a market, like a car which you have to push. I don't think that anybody wants a car which you have to push. Or you want to have a Koskenkorva without alcohol. You just drink it for its taste. So there is no demand. So there are certain things. The funny part is that you can't know things before trying, that if there's a market or not. And did you say running shoes?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, it's a shoes. People have been running, they had their slippers. There was if not direct competitor, there was some other ways of doing it. So it shows that there's a demand. And when CNN was 91, I think, was it? Was launched, and I was like, there can't be a market for the news channel which just shows news. Well, I was like 9 years old at that time. I was like, that's the most stupid thing ever. Nowadays, I really like it that ESPN, I know it's sports, CNN, I know it's news, and then so forth. That there's sometimes that you have a non-focused service, like a general television channel. It has the news, and it has the comedy, and it has the documentaries, and so forth. It has a demand. But then somebody comes up with that, hey, I'm not going to just show documentaries, like History Channel or Discovery Channel, and it comes hugely successful. Because there are certain segments which you can find from the market who don't want to watch anything else except that. There are people who just want to watch History Channel. They don't care about anything else or any novelties. But finding those people, it's kind of tough, and that's why you have to do the segmentation. But there are definitely, there are things which you can't create demand, even if you push as much as you want. Like Nokia mobile phones, they pushed billions for that, and there was no demand. With all of that pushing, there should have been a demand, but there was other options, better ways of doing that. if there's not direct competitors, there are indirect competitors. And that's a good thing to keep in mind. You were a great audience. All right.